All right, assalamu alaikum everybody. Today we are going to talk about antibiotics. Yesterday we talked how we are going to inhibit cell wall growth. Today we'll talk about how exactly we will stop the protein synthesis, right, within the bacteria. Before I start talking about the protein synthesis, how exactly it is happening within bacteria, I would love to talk about the normal process of transcription and translation so that you would understand what I am talking about during the lecture. You see, this is a cell, okay, and within the nucleus, you all know we have DNA, right? So there are two processes involved, which is transcription and translation, in order to do protein synthesis. So many students forget which one comes first. So I usually tell them that you see, C comes first and then L comes later on. So remember it through it, that since C is coming first, so transcription is first, and later on translation will be there, right? In protein synthesis. So what will happen is, we know that DNA is a double helical structure, right? So what will happen is, the DNA would unwind, all right? And then what will happen is, the nucleotides, okay, would start to attach here. You see here, a complementary strand would be made, right? And then this would be mRNA. Here, if you see the difference between DNA and mRNA is, DNA is double helical structure and mRNA is single, right? Single-stranded. So what happens is, the messenger RNA is ready. It has copied the specific gene that encodes for specific protein that needs to be manufactured, right? So for example, here on, let's say this is the entire DNA, okay, where we have, let's just assume, okay? And you want only this gene to be translated, and not the entire, okay, rest of the DNA. So only this part will be activated, and only this part would be copied in the form of messenger RNA, and not the entire length of DNA. All right, we are not doing DNA replication, we are doing protein synthesis here, right? Okay, so what will happen, we have copied the specific orders from the DNA. How exactly the sequence of amino acids should be like, okay? And then the mRNA would then leave the nucleus via nuclear pore. Then they would go to ribosome, okay? Now ribosome, we know that there are two types of ribosomes, right? The two locations, not types, there are two locations. One is that some of the ribosomes would be suspended freely within the cell, okay? And in the other type is that we have endoplasmic reticulum, right? If we talk about normal cell, okay? So there we have endoplasmic reticulum, and then we have ribosomes attached here. In the case of bacteria, ribosomes will be freely, right? And what will happen, mRNA will slide through the ribosome in between the two subunits, okay? And then as a result, you see so many amino acids which would be there in the cytoplasm, they would start to join together to form this amino acid chain. But a lot of amino acids would stick together, right? So what will happen, a chain of amino acid would be formed, and it would be a polypeptide chain. And I'm sure you all know that when a lot of polypeptide chains join together, so they form protein, right? Now let's dig into the topic. So today, the first class we are going to discuss is aminoglycoside. I have attached the slide here, which is kind of a summary, okay, of the entire aminoglycosides. All right. So when we talk about structure and mechanism, okay, so if you look over here on this part of the slide, so here you would see I have attached specifically double membrane of gram-negative bacteria. If you remember, yesterday we talked about gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, right? And then we talked about that in negative bacteria, there are two membranes, right? Outer and inner. And then we have a space called periplasm, right? Okay. So what will happen is that amino glycosides would actually enter into the periplasm through the porin. Okay. This is the channel through which it would enter, and it would start to do its work by there, right? So amino glycosides inhibit bacterial protein synthesis. They are bactericidal against most gram-negative aerobic bacteria. Why aerobic bacteria? Because you see, here we need oxygen, okay? Because when they are getting inside, okay, and when they are doing their actions, so they're doing that by active transport. Let's read about it, okay? That amino glycosides passively diffuse via porin channel. Okay, fine. They entered inside, right? Through the outer membrane of the gram-negative aerobic bacteria, right? Okay. So transport across the inner membrane requires active uptake. That is dependent on electron transport. The so-called energy-dependent phase one transport. Right, everybody? I hope I'm clear about it, that why exactly we are talking about not just gram-negative, but here we are specifying that we need aerobic bacteria to be there, right? Not bacteria, sorry, it's bacteria. Gosh, okay. So inside the cell, these agents interact with receptor proteins on the 30 Sedberg ribosomal subunit. This freezes the initiation complex and leads to buildup of motosome. It also causes translation errors. It means that, okay, if you remember on the first slide, what I did was, you see that a chain was producing, right? So what it would do is this, it would freeze this process, right? And when we are talking about that it is doing translation errors, it means that it is doing all of the work here, right? Okay. So these agents interact with receptor proteins on the 30 Sedberg ribosomal subunit. This freezes the initiation complex and leads to buildup of monosome. It also causes translation errors. Resistance generally results from bacterial enzymes that inactivate the drugs. The resistance contained on plasmids is transmitted by conjugation. If you remember yesterday, I've talked how exactly conjugation works, right? The two bacteria, they come close to each other. The plasmid is transferred from one to another, carrying the message how exactly it is going to play against the antibiotics, right? Okay. So pharmacological properties is that these agents do not penetrate the CSF, okay? Barbara, please go out, Pete. Okay. Now, what is going to happen is here I have attached a flowchart, okay, which contains that what medicines are acting on what medicines are acting on what subunit, okay, and where exactly it's acting. So, first of all, we have DNA supercoil helix, and we have DNA gyrase, which is going to do what? Supercoiled helix and also cunulines is going to act on it. We are not discussing cunulines right now, okay? Rifampin is going to inhibit RNA polymerase. The function of RNA polymerase is to form RNA, okay? So RNA polymerase would be inhibited by rifampin. Then when mRNA goes towards the 30 Sedberg complex, okay, so what happens is there comes up the job of amino glycosides. They stop them working over there. We will discuss about chloramphenicol, okay? So here it is acting when peptide bonds would be formed, right? It would inhibit formation of peptide bonds, right? Then, if you remember, I talked that a chain of amino acids would be produced, right? Forming polypeptides and proteins. So, peptide elongation would be inhibited by erythromycin. Clear, everybody? So, we'll talk about these today. So, selected drugs and their therapeutic uses. The role of amino glycosides has decreased substantially due to their narrow spectrum of activity and toxicity and the availability of other agents. So, streptomycin is currently used only for plague, which is caused by Yersinia pestis. For severe cases of brucellosis and as an adjunct to treat reglaricant mycobacterial infections. Then we have gentamicin and tobramycin, right? So these are active against Enterobacter, Indole-positive, Proteus, Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, and Serratia species, among other gram-negative organisms. So these agents are often used synergistically in combination with beta-lactam antibiotics or vancomycin for serious infections that require broad coverage. Then we have amikacin, which is used to treat severe gram-negative infection, especially those resistant to gentamicin or tobramycin. One suggestion I would do is that you guys divide medicines among each other, okay? And you people create a flow, create a table, okay, which can be a summary that what exactly is treating what, okay? And the conditions that it is curing, okay? All right. Then we have neomycin and kanamycin. Bitter, I am teaching right now, okay? So, neomycin and kanamycin are administered topically for minor soft tissue infections, often in combination with bactericin and polymyxin, or orally for hepatic encephalopathy. Okay, so then we have spectinomycin. So it is structurally related to aminoglycosides and is administered intramuscularly as an alternative for the treatment of acute gonorrhea or in patients hypersensitive to penicillin or for gonococci resistant to penicillin. Wait a minute, everybody. Sorry. Okay. Then we have spectinomycin. It is structurally related to aminoglycosides and is administered intramuscularly as an alternative. Okay, I read it already. Okay. Then we'll talk about the adverse effect. So aminoglycosides have a narrow therapeutic index. It may be necessary to monitor serum concentration and individualize the dose. Wait. Okay, Rumela, that's a good suggestion. Very nice suggestion, in fact. Good. Wow, so smart. Let's study this, okay? So aminoglycosides are ototoxic, affecting either vestibular or cochlear auditory functions, okay? So aminoglycosides, particularly gentamicin, neomycin, and tobramycin are nephrotoxic. They produce acute tubular necrosis that leads to a reduction in the glomerular filtration rate and arise in serum keratinin and blood urea nitrogen. So damage is usually reversible. At high doses, these agents produce a cure-like neuromuscular blockage with respiratory paralysis. So calcium gluconate and neurostigmine are the antidotes. Aminoglycosides are rarely cause hypersensitivity reactions, except spectinomycin and neomycin, which when applied topically can cause contact dermatitis in as many as 8% of the patients. Then we'll talk about tetracyclines. So when we talk about the structure and mechanism of action, so tetracyclines are derivatives of naphthacene carboxamide. So tetracyclines bind reversibly to 37 subunit of bacterial ribosome. This prevents the binding of aminosyl tRNA to the receptor site on the mRNA ribosome complex and the addition of amino acid to the growing peptide, thus inhibiting bacterial protein synthesis. These agents are bacteriostatic. If you remember, when I talked that amino acids are there in the cytoplasm, okay? So messenger RNA, we have already talked that they are bringing the message, right? Now the job of tRNA is to pick up the amino acids from the cytoplasm and attach those amino acids in a row, okay? All right. So resistance is plasmid mediated and results primarily from a decreased ability to accumulate in the bacteria and from the production of an inhibitor of the binding sites of tetracycline. Resistance to one tetracycline confers resistance to some, but not all, congeners. So pharmacological property, when we talk about these, so tetracyclines are variably but adequately absorbed from GIT. They can also be administered parenterally. Then we have ticillin. An exception is only administered IV. Absorption is impaired by stomach contents, especially milk and antacids. Tetracyclines are distributed throughout body fluids. Therapeutic concentrations in the brain and CSF can be achieved with minocycline. The primary route of elimination for most tetracycline is kidney, and doxycycline and ticycline do not accumulate and hence are the safest tetracycline to administer to individuals with impaired renal functions. So many tetracyclines undergo enterohepatic recirculation. I've already talked about what is enterohepatic recirculation, so I'm not talking about it. When we talk about spectrum and therapeutic uses, so tetracyclines are active against both gram-negative and gram-positive organisms, but the use of these agents is declining because of increased resistance and the development of safer drugs. So tetracyclines are used predominantly for the treatment of rickettsial infections. First of all, let's talk about what's rickettsial infections. So you see, these rickettsial infections are caused by these, okay? Ticks, fleas, lice, mites, okay? So these cause rickettsial infection. And you see, the rickettsia is actually there within the host cell, okay? Feeding on it. So it's an obligate intracellular parasite. Gram-negative pleomorphic bacteria. So you see the entire, so the infection is actually caused by these, okay? So we will talk about as an example of these rickettsial infections. So we'll see the Rocky Mountain infection, okay? So it looks like this, that all of a sudden, you know, you have a high-grade fever and you have blotches like these, okay? on your body. So Rocky Mountain spotted fever. So the name of this rickettsial infection is this, okay? Then we have cholera, Lyme disease, and infection caused by Chlamydia species and Mycoplasma pneumonia. So these agents may be useful for the treatment of inflammatory acne vulgaris. So they are used in combination regimens for the element of infections caused by Helicobacter pylori. Demiclocycline is used in refractory cases of syndrome of inappropriate secretion of antidiuretic hormone. So it interferes with the addition with the action of ADH at the renal collecting duct by impairing the generation and action of cyclic AMP. So ticillin has a broad spectrum of activity and has activity against tetracycline resistant organisms. When we talk about the adverse effects, so tetracyclines produce GI upsetness, including nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. At higher doses, most tetracyclines can cause hepatic damage, particularly in pregnant women. So when exposed to strong UV light, as in sunlight, these agents, demiclocycline in particular, can cause dermatological reactions. Tetracycline can complex with calcium in bone. Children aged 6 months to 5 years receive tetracycline therapy can develop tooth discolorations. So these agents can also retard bone growth in neonates. Tetracyclines can cause superinfection by resistant staphylococci or clostridia as a result of altered GI ecology. This condition can be life-threatening. Chloramphenicol. So when we talk about structure and mechanism of action, so chloramphenicol inhibits bacterial protein synthesis by binding to bacterial 50 Sedwer ribosomal subunit to block the action of peptidyl transferase, and thus prevents amino acid incorporation into newly formed peptides. So high concentrations inhibit eukaryote mitochondrial protein synthesis. Resistance results from the production of plasmid-encoded acetyltransferase capable of inactivating the drug. When we talk about pharmacological properties, so chloramphenicol is absorbed rapidly and distributed throughout body fluids. Therapeutic levels can be obtained in the CSF. An inactive food drug, chloramphenicol succinate, is used for parenteral administration. On absorption, it is hydrolyzed by plasma esterases. So it inhibits cytochrome P50 isozymes. Therapeutic uses its broad spectrum bacteriostatic antibiotic. It is active against most gram-negative organisms, many anaerobes, clostridia, chlamydia, mycoplasma, and rickettsia. However, because of potential for severe and sometimes fatal adverse effects, so use of these agents is limited to the treatment of infections that cannot be treated with other drugs. So these infections include typhoid fever, meningitis due to H influenza in patients allergic to penicillins and the new cephalosporins, and some instances of infections caused by ampicillin-resistant strains. So chloramphenicol may be used for the treatment of certain anaerobic infections of brain in combination with penicillin, and as an alternative to tetracycline in the treatment of rickettsial disease and topically for infections of the eye. When we talk about adverse effects, so chloramphenicol causes dose-related bone marrow suppression, resulting in pancytopenia that may lead to irreversible aplastic anemia. This effect has low incidence but a high mortality rate. Also, chloramphenicol causes hemolytic anemia in patients with low level of glucose, 6-phosphate dehydrogenase. Then Chloramphenicol causes reticulocytopenia, perhaps as a result of the inhibition of mitochondrial protein synthesis. So this is actually the main cell, which reticulocyte is the main cell from which furthermore cells are developed that are present in the blood, right? Okay. So neonates given large doses of chloramphenicol develop gray baby syndrome. This syndrome results from the inadequacy of both cytochrome P50 and glucuronic acid conjugation system to detoxify the drug. So elevated plasma chloramphenicol levels cause a shock-like syndrome and a reduction in peripheral circulation. The incidence of fatalities is 40%. So chloramphenicol inhibition of cytochrome P50 isozyme can result in elevated and toxic effects of other drugs as well. Now we'll talk about erythromycin, clarithromycin, azithromycin, and telithromycin. So when we talk about their structure, Sadaf Khan, thank you for raising it. So erythromycin inhibits protein synthesis by binding irreversibly to bacterial 50 Sedberg ribosomal subunit. It inhibits amino acyl translocation and the formation of initiation complexes. It is usually bacteriostatic, but at high concentration can be bactericidal. Resistance is plasmid encoded and is prevalent in most strains of staphylococci and to some extent in streptococci. It is due primarily to increased active influx of ribosomal protection by increased methylase production. So adverse effects when we talk about, so erythromycin and other macrolides cause GI dysfunction, but rarely produce serious adverse effects. The oral form of erythromycin may cause allergic cholestatic hepatitis, which is readily reversible by cessation of the drug. Erythromycin has a high incidence of thrombophlebitis when administered IV. So erythromycin and clarithromycin inhibit hepatic cytochrome P450 mediated metabolism of warfarin, phenytoin, and others, possibly leading to toxic accumulation. So azithromycin is devoid of this action. Then we'll talk about the pharmacological properties. So you see, erythromycin is inactivated by stomach acid and is therefore administered as an enteric-coated tablet. So erythromycin distributes into all body fluids except the brain and CSF. In therapeutic uses, it is active against gram-positive organisms. So these agents is useful as penicillin substitute in penicillin hypersensitive patients. Erythromycin is most effective drug for Legionnaire's disease. So it is also useful for the treatment of syphilis and pneumonia, coronary bacterial infections, and a whooping cough that you know, right? That is due to, that is the Bordetella pertussis disease. So azithromycin is commonly used for community-acquired walking pneumonia and sinusitis. So clarithromycin or azithromycin is effective in the multi-drug regimen treatment of disseminated mycobacterium, avium, intracellular complex infections in AIDS patient. Then we have clindamycin. So it acts similar to erythromycin. It can be administered orally and is well distributed throughout body fluids except for the CNS. Use of clindamycin is limited to alternative therapy of abscesses associated with infections caused by aerobes such as B. Fraglis. It is used in dental patients with valvular heart disease for prophylaxis of endocarditis. So topical preparations of the drug are used for the treatment of acne. So clindamycin produces diarrhea, which is observed in up to 20% of individuals, potential severe pseudomembranous colitis occurs as a result of superinfections by resistant Clostridia. Thank you, everybody.